So welcome along to the Skapade show. This is episode number 22 and we are joined with the amazingly talented Chris McQueer.
Hi boys. Yes.
So we are live here in Skapade Studios for a special episode of the Skapade podcast. We don't usually live stream them. If you'd been on the first stream, that's probably why, because some technical issues, but we're all good. We've sorted it now. So we're joined with Mr. Chris McQueer.
Hi, boys.
And it's great to have you back on, mate.
Cheers, pleasure. Come back, man.
This is the second time we've actually had Chris on. One time was about over a year ago. So much has happened in that year. How have you been, mate?
Magic, mate. Knackered, stressed out, but loving life, mate. It's good, man.
Well, I mean, you went from... So your last time you were here, you were basically... You just wrote Hings. Mm-hmm. So that was... You just basically finished that. Mm-hmm. And then you were still working. Were you full-time still in Greaves or part-time?
Full-time working in DW Sports Rope up in... Glasgow Fort, man, selling Fallabits and running shoes and that.
Yeah.
I just released that book, Girl Hings. But since then, I know I'm full time writing and I still can't believe it, mate.
So amazing to see you.
That's amazing. So, how long ago was that?
When was that? That would have been July last year.
That's when you made the call.
That's that. And then it was just December last year, December 2017. That's when I made the call. I was like, I'm going to try and. Mm-hmm. Do this or go. I'm going to see if I can do this full time, see if I can make a living for it.
Amazing. Mm-hmm. How does that look then, from going from working that job to full time? Did you have to create a structure of a day, or do you find you work better at night or daytime? How did you kind of work that out?
Big time. So the first maybe couple of weeks gone full time, it's like, oh, brilliant, man. Just lazing about all day. You know what I mean? I was hard to do anything. I was
writing.
Sitting about thinking, trying to inspiration, man.
Coffee shops.
That's it, mate. Just dusting about all day. And then after like a couple of weeks, I just felt my brain turn into mush. It's like, wow, man, I need to sort this out, man. Start structuring it. You know what I mean? That's what made me take myself more seriously as a writer. And that's what kind of gave me a wee kick up the arse as well. Mm-hmm. So then, you know, start getting up at the same time every day. Make sure you're doing the same stuff. Make sure you're getting in like 3-4 hours writing every day. Just making sure you're sticking to that every day and getting that discipline, and that's what kind of keeps you going, man. You need that. It's like when guys go into the jail, that's what they talk about. You need a routine. That's what I feel like, man. Like, keep yourself sane. Like.
No, it's so mad once you make that call. I guess if you're lucky enough to make the call as a creative and then you do take it seriously, having that structure is probably the next challenge you face, isn't it?
Like, that's it, man.
Because like, the lure of going, right, I can do what I want now.
It's too tempting, man. Like, it's too easy.
I'll get a quick game in.
I'll get the gaming in first, then I'll.
I've actually, that YouTube video looks all right, so I'll watch that. Stimulate some ideas.
My routine for the first couple of weeks was like, fuck it, it was like Football Manager for like 12 in the afternoon until 8 at night, and then conspiracy videos on YouTube, tell past it, and wake up and do it again. And it's like, well, I'm trying to get inspiration, man, for stories, isn't it? Heat was wasted, man.
So you've got a routine now then. Does that look?
It's a lot better now. So it's like every day I'm up at like 8:30. So that was no purely early. You know what I mean? I know a lot of writers talk about getting up at like 5 a.m. and that, but I think that's madness. Mm-hmm.
So that's depends just, by the person as well.
It's all right on the person, man. For me, like that would kind of make me hate writing, I think, if you're really rigidly sticking to getting up at that time in the morning, forcing yourself to do it and writing for like 12, 14 hours a day, then it doesn't becomes like a chore almost. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, I don't want to lose that kind of passion that I've got for it. You know what I mean? That kind of scares me a wee bit. So it's get up in the morning, something to eat, take a dog out, and then write as much as I can until I get stuck, basically. Mm-hmm. And if I do get stuck, go on a wee quick walk with the dog. We need to read a lot as well. That's the main thing as well, I found. That the more you read, the better you get at writing, which is really cool. So it's like, I think Stephen King, he always says, you know, if you've not got time to read, you don't have time to write. Reading should be a priority, and we are writing, which is quite cool.
Because, wow.
That's amazing.
Stuff like that, man.
So what do you read then? Do you read a lot of Stephen King? Or?
Read a lot, man. I read like
everything,
anything, like, mate, and I can get my hands on. So I just want to see what other writers are doing and like what they do well and then the kind of mistakes they're making and like, you know, try and avoid that and then try and get good at what they're good at and stuff.
How
like
they
that.
Describe like, things and all that.
Man, it's good, man. It's just try to absorb everything and just keep trying to get better. That's what I'm all about, man. So.
You do seem really descriptive in your text, though. Like when you're explaining a story, it's that I feel like I'm placing myself in a situation, like actually reading and being there.
Aye.
And that's a difficult skill to do.
Aye.
You know, and I guess it's like listening to music, isn't it? It's like you get the structure of a tune down, and the more you listen and listen, it gives you other ideas for other tracks and stuff, and you go, right, well, I know how that producer puts things together. It's kind of the same with the writing, but you're putting your own thing.
Aye, definitely.
That's amazing.
What
have you felt has then really changed since Hings came out? Because Hings has created all sorts of hype. I mean, it's been pretty mental the year. I mean, we can obviously dive into some of the stuff.
Aye.
You've like been doing stuff with TV, adverts, all sorts of stuff. So tell me when you really felt like, Christ, the momentum here's really picking up, and like, I feel like this could do something for me.
Aye. Well, like, straight away when the book came out last July, that just changed my life. Do you know what I mean? Like, I was mad. Do you know what I mean? Like getting asked to go into interviews all the time, and like, I was just, you know, seeing on Twitter people were buying my book and that was mad. Like, seeing reviews and that was just surreal. And then when you get the kind of good reviews, that gives you a wee confidence boost. You're like, right, man, maybe I can do this for a living. Do you know what I mean? So at the time when that came out, I wasn't really thinking about doing it for a living. It was just,
I was writing
for a hobby.
Yeah.
And I was just putting my stories online just to see what happened. I was trying to make my pals laugh. And then a publisher kind of got in touch with me. And then I was like, all right, maybe there is something here. Maybe I've got something here. Maybe I'm onto something. And then it got published. The book came out. And I was like, right, fuck. I could maybe do this for a living, right? And then, so it was just all about like self-promo and that. Try to sell books and like trying to, and then just keep writing, try to get better on that. And then it was once I quit my job, that was when like you start taking it serious. You know what I mean? That's when it goes from being a hobby. Right, this is my job. This is my career. This is... if I want to keep doing this for the rest of my life, if I want to keep getting better, I need to just keep writing and keep pushing myself and really take it seriously. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Take myself seriously as a writer, which that was a big change. You know what I mean?
That's good.
That was good, man. So
there was a moment I remember when you were writing that book where we were kind of communicating, and you did seem a little bit sort of distant in the sense of, I think you were really putting a lot of stress on yourself to get that finished.
Aye, man.
Because it's one thing writing one book, but then to follow up with another one with the hype that you have created. Aye. And obviously you're already massively popular online. You get a lot of traction through Twitter and stuff with your banter. So what was the pressure like? Because we kind of spoke about that over the last few months. Aye. Like, what was the pressure of like meeting deadlines and actually finishing a book you were happy with when you'd only started off as a hobby first time round?
It was unreal, mate. It was totally different game writing my new book, HWFG. That was unreal, mate. It was proper pressure that I wasn't really expecting. You know what I mean? So I wrote that, I was just a laugh, just writing whenever I wanted to do it. But then with this one, no, I had a deadline for the publishers, right? It needs to be in by then, we need this amount of words. And I'm like, right, well, fuck, it needs to be good. You know what I mean? It needs to be as good, if not better, as the first book.
Yeah.
So then you just start stressing, mate, and then
soon does that affect your creative performance, do you think, then?
It did a wee bit, man. Like, see at the start, like, see maybe the first like half a dozen stories I wrote for the new book, they were just terrible, mate, because I was just putting so much pressure on myself to like try and be funny, and I was like trying to be funny, like trying too hard. I was just like, I'd finish a story and I'd go, that's shocking. Move on to something else. God, that's even worse. Like, what is going on here? I've lost it. You know what I mean? Maybe I'm just a fucking one-hit wonder. And then it felt like the first couple of stories I wrote, it felt like somebody was trying to do like a parody of Hings. Somebody was kind of kidding on the world. Like me, right, that was weird, mate. It was really surreal. And I was just losing the plot, mate. Honestly, I felt as if I was losing the plot.
Yeah.
And so I was at college as well at the time. So as soon as that came out, I went to college to study creative writing to try and get better. And that was a massive help. That kind of helped me get my head screwed on and like start thinking more about my writing. And that forced me to get better as well. Like, learning how to properly write. Cause when I was writing Hings, that was just like, just winging it really. But then when you go to college, you learn how to structure stuff properly and like you learn all the rules for creative writing and that. So that was really good. But then once I kind of, most of that book was wrote like within probably about a 3 month period. Do you know what I mean? I started writing it straight after that came out. So that was July last year. But like I say, everyone was wrong.
The majority of the good stuff.
All the good stuff was like in the last kind of 3 or 4 months. By the stress and that, it was unreal, mate. It was unreal.
Do you think that's just breaking the mould, though? Like when the first few stories you put out, as you say, they were a bit rubbish in your mind. So it's kind of like you had to break that in first before you got to the good stuff. It was like you had to get rid of the shit.
Basically, mate, I think that's what it is. And as well, like, I was trying to make my new book like Hings, because I thought, well, that's what people like, that's why I'd done so well. But you keep churning out the same kind of stuff, and you're never going to grow. As a writer, same with music as well. So
yeah,
I thought, right, I'm going to change my approach here, change my attitude, change my style, change the tone and all that. So I just went a wee bit darker, you know what I mean? Steady. Hings is, I'm really proud of Hings, I really, really liked it, but it's quite like slapstick humour, and it's quite quite light-hearted at times. And I thought, with this new one, I'm going to try and go a wee bit darker, I'm going to try and get a wee bit weirder, get a wee bit more surreal, and see where I can take that. And that changed it. That's what, everything started to click once I'd done that, once I changed it up, and it was, that got the ball rolling, man. And then having a deadline on me, that was good. Like, it was stressful, but forces you to write every day, and forces you to put the hours in, which was good. And
so
good, man.
I came and seen you do a talk
in the Partick Library.
And I really enjoyed that. It was a good night, and it was good to see you doing your thing. I already know, just from watching videos and seeing what you've done now, even since then, you probably feel that you've developed so much even for that night. How has the whole book readings and tours been going? Have you been doing any stand up or anything like that?
It's been good, man. I love performing, I love reading out my work. That was something I didn't know you could do. I didn't know you could go on stage and read out stories when Hings came out. And then
it's the nature of the stories, though. They're so funny. They're actually so good.
I don't know, man. Like, see, because I've been doing this, I've started writing now with a view to, like, performing. So, like, I write the story and then I kind of read it out, and then I'll change it, like, try and imagine where people would laugh and stuff, and that's kind of changed my writing. That's kind of made me better, I think, as well.
From performing?
Aye, definitely.
That's
good, man. I love performing, man. Tried a wee bit of stand-up. I done a wee bit of stand-up at the Glasgow Comedy Festival at the start of the year. That was back in March. And,
different ball game, innit?
It's good. I enjoyed it, man.
I can't think of anything harder.
No, mate. It was,
like,
oh,
actually
murder,
having
man.
To go around here.
It's murder,
make
man.
These people laugh.
Make me laugh. In a dark room.
Aye, man.
Make me laugh.
For silence in a dark room, they're all that anticipating waiting.
Where do you even begin?
Honestly, see, writing like half an hour stand-up routine, that was so much harder than.
So you actually done half an hour? That's a lot.
Half an hour, mate, and it was terrifying, mate. Enjoyed it. It was good, but I'll never do it again.
Right, aye. So how did you feel it went?
I thought it went well. Aye.
Did you have a lot of your fans there?
It was basically a full room with, like, my family and my pals. It was like a 100-seater kind of room. And it was just mostly like my pals and my family, so that was kind of good, you know what I mean? And then there was a few kind of like people that just liked the book,
and
that
people
just kind of turned
and
up that. So but it was really good. I really enjoyed it, but I preferred then reading some of my stories, you know what I mean? I think I'm better at that.
You know what the content
no,
is
like,
you've got it's
not
it,
inside
done.
Out aye, like, and you've got that kind of shield as well, like, if you put your book in front of you, you can just look at that, whereas we stand up, you're kind of like,
you're relying
totally
on your
open,
mind.
Man.
Your naked, basically.
Aye, man. That's what just there, totally exposed. Like.
We were talking about that just there. You were asking about the hydro and that. And,
aye.
And for me, I need the anchor points, like,
aye.
Or I will freak out.
Aye.
Like, I can't really not have the either something really memorised or not in front of me, or having
aye.
Notes or something like that, just
aye,
so you've got that kind of fallback.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh.
I think you can, if you've got that kind of that anchor there, it's, for me it's easier, whereas you're the complete opposite.
See,
you know?
I'm the king of winging that way, but at the same time, that's not always a good thing either. So
know,
it does, it's good to balance it out and have some structure, but I think you need the flexibility. Well, for me anyway, I like the flexibility of being able to go off.
Aye, aye, aye.
Because I don't ever stick to a plan.
It looked terrifying, but it looked brilliant, man.
Mm. It was insane.
Aye, that's exactly, you summed it up perfectly there. Terrifying, but brilliant.
Aye.
You know? It's like, even watching the video back's mental, you know, and it's like you can see that wee moment we have just as we walk out onto the stage, we look at each other like, what are we doing here, man?
How did we end up here?
This should not be happening, man. But, you know, it felt good, though. It felt like we've walked to a point of that, you know what I mean, and continually so well. And that's what I'm saying. It's so good to see yourself from last year. How much you've came on as well.
Yeah, yeah.
With all parties have been insanely busy.
That's been good, man.
It's great. Scotland's in a good place. You know, there's a lot of great, amazing creative talents around, you know, and it's good to get guys like yourself into, you know, chat about it.
It really is. Yeah, well, basically, I've seen, so since you came, and in the book and stuff, and you've been developing now as an artist, right? You are more focal in terms of like video content, stuff like that. So well, let's start with the BBC, the social. So you did stuff and it was a bit like it was actually giving tips to writers how to write better and stuff.
It was like they just asked me, you know, can we make a wee video about you, just your kind of like your life story, how you get into writing, and then what tips would you get new writers and stuff, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And that was brilliant, man. It was really, really.
So what did you feel that, did that help to boost your profile?
Big time, man. I like loads of new followers off the back of it, and then loads of book sales and that. I think like for a writer, it's really important that you get your, same with music as well, you get your personality across as well. Do you know what I mean? People buy into you as a person as much as what you're creating, which is quite good. So that's good. Like, because with being a writer, you're kind of seen as being just kind of faceless, like behind the scenes. You put your book out, you're never really in public. That's kind of stereotype.
Unless
like,
you put the author picture in the back, man,
like there's a kind of stereotype authors, it's like old guys and old women, they're just like pure recluses, hermits, like sitting at a typewriter and that. Like, that's not the case. Like, if you can put yourself out there and if you can get your personality, it's a big, big help.
So definitely, same goes for music as well.
Just think it's a mad geek in a producer room or something. But
I mean, not so much DJs these days, but you know, writers in general are writing music. You know, it's quite a reclusive thing you're actually doing, but there's another thing attached to it as well. You know, like you can, it's good to attach the personality to it. It's what makes the ultimate kind of the buy-in is the personality, isn't it?
I think not only that though, like music and writing and films, like creativity in general, like it has such a feeling for people. You know, so it's like you know, I've met fans of Stephen when we are like in Rotterdam and there's like people with like pictures of him printed out in a flag and all that, one that signed from like Korea and all that, and it's, you're kind of like, man, when you actually think of where music or writing or creativity, how it can touch someone,
crazy, isn't it?
It's like, and now through social media, and that's why I'm asking about like the BBC thing, that blowing you up, that now makes you more viable in other areas of UK, you know, outside Scotland as well.
Aye, man.
So what has been some of the best feedback you've heard since that, and what do you feel is the difference now with the, now that you're coming to release your second book, how do you feel it's different for the first?
Feedback's been like 99% positive, which is better than
I thought. We want to talk about that 1% negative.
Get to that. But honestly, man, like, feedback and the reviews and that just proper blown me away. Like Martin Compston got a hold of the book and he was tweeting about it saying how good it was and how much he loved it, and that was surreal, man. Like, it's Mark Compton, though, it's like A-list, man.
Amazing.
Couldn't believe that was one of the highlights. Like, just like checking Twitter one day and you refresh it, and it's Martin Compton talking about my book. I'm like, what is going on?
I think
here,
I seen you tweet about that, and you were just were blown away.
It was like a wee lassie, mate. It was like a wee lassie. So I was like, seeing wee lassies meet like Justin Bieber and that. Like, that was me, mate. Screaming that. Bah, you won't believe this. Shouting my mom and like,
that's that's amazing, mate. That's what it's all about.
Aye, man. And, so like I was saying to you earlier, like I don't know how this new book's going to go down, because like a wee change in tone for the first book and that, and like other reviews have been done, but I won't see them until the week the book comes out. So now I'm just in this like no man's land where I don't know how it's going to go, mate. It's done.
You're waiting on again released.
I've got 2 weeks now, but it's just like I don't know how it's going to go. Like,
so what do you do in these 2 weeks right now? Are you just working on trying to promo the actual release date of
I don't stop working, mate. So like, all the kind of promo stuff they know, and then I'm working on like my next book as well. So it's just constant. You need to keep at it, man. You need to keep the ball rolling, just keep the momentum going. That's it, man.
So the thing is, do you think all roads lead back to the books then for you? Like, that's your main outlet for getting your stuff out, like, and obviously interviews are there as well, and bits and bobs, you know, maybe TV appearances and stuff, but for you, is it, that's it, it's like each book defines you at a moment in your career, kind of thing. Like, is that how you look at it?
I think so, man. I like to try and, like, when I was kind of struggling to write this new book, what I kind of looked at was like Arctic Monkeys and how they do it. Like, every album's got a totally different sound, and I was like, well, if they can do it, then maybe I can do that with books. Like, maybe I can kind of change it up from book to book, and like, that would be quite cool today. So if you're just putting out the same kind of stuff now again, people are going to get bored. I'm not going to get any better as a writer, so that's what I wanted to try and do. So I think you're right.
What I think you've done here though is you've kept essences from the first book
Aye.
So that it's like, I say this to you all the time. It's like when you find like a new musician that you really like, right, and you hear one of their tunes and you've got it on repeat, right? It's like one of their songs. And then you're like, oh man, I wish they'd do other stuff like this. Aye. And you go and listen to their tunes, and some of their tunes are similar.
Aye.
And you're like, yes.
You can
just
tell it's them.
You can tell it's them. So I think that's what you've done with Hearway, you know. And it's like, because I think it's like, because it still says short stories in that from the first one. So it's clearly still that. Mm-hmm. So you're keeping that sort of context, but you've went a bit of a darker direction, basically.
Aye.
We've given the Hings our original copies either... I don't know where it is because we've been...
Lorca Lee had it, but he brought it back.
Oh, no way.
He did. I think you've got it in your flat. Aye, so Lorca came in, gave him it. He loved it.
Aye.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
Yes, he loved
Lorca
it, mate.
Had it.
Legend.
He brought it back to me, though.
He did. I think it's in your flat.
Is it?
It is. Joe, it's funny, Lorca Lee gets a mention in every podcast. Every single one. He just creeps in. He's very artistic himself in that, but he loved it. We knew it'd be up his street, he brought it back and he loved it, mate.
That's
mad, mate. So it is up his street, though.
It is. I'm sure he'll get the second one as well. Good, you've now got a new follower, which is good. So the next video content-wise... Am I right in saying you did some stuff with the Bank of Scotland for an advert or something?
I did, man. I was just kind of online, so it was like it's kind of corporate. It was like, you know, talk about like staying safe online, like how you use the internet, like for your business, and that. Because I suppose this is a business for me. This is my wee.
Absolutely. Kinda,
so how important social media has been, that, and like how we stay safe online and how not to get like scammed and all that kind of stuff. It was good, man.
So what are your tips then? I'd love
what
to know.
What are my tips?
How do you stay safe online for children?
Oof, man.
It's not easy, because the thing is, though, I think you're a good guy to ask, though, because you've got a massive following online, and like your tweets go really viral, and like people love your banter. So it's like, how do you go about it without crossing too many lines?
It's weird, man. Do you forget sometimes that you're putting loads of personal information on Twitter and stuff, and you forget loads of people will see it. It's not just, you're not just shouting into the void kind of thing. Like,
yeah.
People, they see it, and that kind of freaks me out sometimes. Like, it's weird, man. Like, sometimes, like, I'll meet somebody that's read the book in the pub, and they'll ask me, like, oh, how's Vanessa, your girlfriend? And I'm like, I don't even know who you are, mate. How do you even know my girlfriend? Yeah. It's pure weird.
But
like, you forget, like,
yeah.
talking about social media every day, you know what I mean? It's so weird, mate. It's so weird, man.
When are you going to get the dog on Instagram?
I know, I need to get him, man.
Wee man.
I know.
Wee man's getting famous.
I know, mate, he's overtaking me, man.
but I think that is funny again, though, just like, because you're now in a position where you're getting sort of bigger through your banter online and stuff, right? So with Scottish banter comes absolute ruthlessness, right? There's no survivors when it comes to Scottish banter, right? But now, because you are taking this down a professional route, you obviously have publishers and people looking and stuff. Are you a little bit cautious sometimes when you're putting certain things out and going, do you know what, I might not be able to put that out because it might affect getting a corporate job or are you still like, I couldn't care less, I'm being me?
A wee bit, mate, is in the back of my mind.
It should be if you're taking it professionally.
That's it, man. You don't want to ruin everything, you know what I mean? One bad tweet and that's you. You could damage your career, like, irreparably, you know what I mean? That could be you gubbed. So, like,
you see it happening all the time, don't you?
I know, man. It's just...
It's scary.
It's just common sense, really, you know what I mean? See, if you just don't be a dick, you'll be fine. That's my kind of mantra, you know what I mean?
Like, that's probably the best way to stay safe online, because just don't be a dick.
Aye, man.
So, well, now, in talking about that, in trouble in Twitter and stuff, you've been in a bit of hot bother with Twitter.
Oh, man, aye.
So you got banned a few months ago.
Get banned.
So what happened?
August, get my account deleted, permanently
deleted.
Banned. Aye, man. Basically, I was on holiday with my girlfriend. We were in Portugal, start of August. We're sitting having lunch, and our phone buzzed on the table, and she picked up. She was flicking through it, and she went like that to me. Who's Loic Remy? I was like, Loic Remy? He's a football player.
A massive French footballer.
He's like, pure international superstar football player. I was like, what's the script? Is he signing for Celtic or something? I was like, what's happening? And she's like, no, he's just sent me a message on Instagram. I was like, no way. It won't be hammered, but like, why are these wee guys seeing them? Like, the wee kind of English guys, like, they use like a football player as a profile picture and they just send people abuse on Twitter. Yeah. A wee guy like that. I was like, show his man. She showed me a phone and it was him, man. Like, blue tick, verified,
no way.
Filing into him. I was like, what's going on here, man? Football player's filing into my missus. This is mental.
Aye.
And but that was it. I never really thought anything else yet.
Right.
And then it was maybe a week after we get back, I was in the pub with my girlfriend's dad. And I was telling him about it, we were kind of laughing about it. Then after a few pints, he was getting me pure wound up a bit. He's like, you should say something to him. I wouldn't be having that, man. I was like, you know, like 6 pints deep. Like, I'm going to tell him, man. I'm going to get him told, man. We're on Twitter, man. I was like, I'm going to fucking kill Loic Remy.
That's what you wrote.
That's word for word, mate. That's what I wrote, right?
And tagged him in it.
I couldn't find him on Twitter.
Right.
But I think somebody then tagged him in it, like underneath the tweet, like
right.
By his fans or something. And so I tweeted that and then like went to bed. I woke up in the morning, had all sorts of notifications that kind of went kind of viral, you know what I mean? Everybody's talking about it. Like, and I was like, man, I've just threatened to kill a football player. I need to come off Twitter. So I deleted the Twitter app off my phone. I was aye. Like, fucking, that was days, man. That's that, put to bed. And then maybe the next night or something, I was thinking to myself, I was like, I've made a death threat to a football player. Like, I need to delete that. That's dodgy, man. Like, I was like, wow, man. Downloaded Twitter again. Went back home, tried to log into my account. Your account's been banned. I was like, what's going on here, man? Check my emails. I had an email for Twitter. You've been banned for threatening and abusive behaviour. I was like, oh my God. I was like, pure appealing it. I was like, you know, Twitter's how I make a living, it's how I sell books. It's just a joke. I didn't mean it. I'm not actually going to kill him. Like, and they were like, nah, banned. That's you. So, like, I've like set up a new Twitter account and I'm hoping they won't find me.
Right, so you're actually banned then?
Somewhat banned for Twitter, but I'm using
for
it.
For good?
Like, for good, man, aye. So that's how like, I've set up this weekend. I've set up my new account, which is right. Like Chris McQueer by _.
Right.
But, no, like, he hasn't.
No,
he hasn't.
So, apparently, let's see if you get banned for threatening abusive behaviour on Twitter. Like, if they find you've made a new account, they'll shut that down. If you start a new one, they'll shut that down. So I'm, under the radar. I've, changed everything, all the kind of personal details I've signed up with are all incognito kind of stuff. It's mental, man.
Oh my God.
So it's just that probably just a matter of time before I get banned again, but I'll just keep coming back.
Definitely aliases.
So what's the deal then? So the actual original account, you've had to start a completely fresh one?
I just had to start a new account.
New everything. And did you find all the old brigades for the old McQueer followers have jumped over?
That's it, mate. It's just near enough everybody's back out, you know what I mean?
Or raging because you've been cut. They'll all hate Remy.
I need hard feelings, Remy.
So, did you ever get a reply for Remy or that? Did you ever hear that ever happened?
Idea, I don't even know if he knows.
He's probably embarrassed.
He's not caring, he probably
he's
is.
He's probably quite embarrassed.
What was he up to at the start anyway? You know?
So, I know. So, just he was just trying to fire in a bit your missus and trying to lure her in with his money and his skills on a ball.
These guys, man, that just float about.
I know, just trying to fire in about somebody else's bird.
Right on Instagram like that, flaunting their blue text status.
I know, I've got hundreds of cash, I'm getting with a football.
Jeez,
that was mad.
That's a
proper
crazy.
Surreal, mate. Proper surreal.
Wow, so
people don't believe it. When I try and tell my mates on Twitter, they just don't believe it. I'm like,
I think this is a good story though, just for people because people are out there scared to maybe say something or they might think it's the end of the world when they get banned.
Aye,
when it's actually not at all.
I thought that as well. I thought
you would have first
banned for Twitter, man. This is how I sell books. Publisher's going to be raging. So I did all my promo and stuff. This is it. This is me. Career's finished.
If anything, it's more hype.
That's it, man. You can step back and you go, calm down. It's not that bad. Just start again.
Exactly.
It's just a big game, you know what I mean? It's just trying to follow us and all that kind of stuff. It's just a big game. It's just a laugh in it. That's the way I see it, man.
I mean, it's just, it's kind of like the whole McGregor smashing the bus window in New York and all that. It's like they shouldn't have, you'd have thought that's the worst thing ever, but that just built even more hype. So it's kind of the same with you. Like, Chris McQueer's been banned. That makes Chris McQueer even hotter now because it's like, well, who is? Why is he banned? Oh, he was ripping at your friend's football. Oh, he threatened to kill Remy. He can't even make it up.
It's mad, mate.
So I'm glad because my pal can watch this. He was asking me last night, you need to press him about the Remy thing. He's like, he might not want to talk about that though. Everybody's been talking about it. He might be raging that bit.
Nah, man. That's funny, isn't it, man?
You've been playing football recently.
Of me,
right? Now, tying this into football, you like that segue there. I never even meant that.
Smooth, mate. Smooth as. So, Parkinson there, man.
So it was like a charity match, wasn't it?
Aye, man, charity.
Was it Rangers Celtic or something?
Rangers Celtic, mate. I was playing for Celtic.
Why, obviously you've been a Celtic league.
I'm a Celtic league, aye, good Celtic boy. So I was playing beside ex-Celtic players like Rudy Vata, Simon Donnelly. Mark Wilson was playing.
I must have been a dream come true for you, mate.
Best day of my life, genuinely. Yeah. By a mile, best day of my life. See, just being in the dressing room and getting a team talk after Frank McGarvey, Celtic legend, man. And then we were on the pitch and ran the huddle and they played the Champions League music.
No,
we came out the tunnel, mate. Oh, man, I couldn't believe it, man. I was just pure, like,
wow,
starstruck. Like, I was playing right wing, so I've got Matt Wilson, like, ex-Celtic right back, playing behind me. He's telling me what to do. He's like, go and see Chris, do this. Oh, mate, amazing. Couldn't believe it.
How are you, football no bad?
Shite, mate. Shite.
Yes! I was hoping that.
See, big Rudy Vata, big Albanian Celtic legend. He was playing at centre-back, and he was just ripping into man. Like,
was he raging with you?
I was raging. It was raging with everybody, man. But me especially.
But were you love getting a telling to by
it, I was loving it. Like, get shouted at for Celtic legend, man. This is brilliant, mate. It's brilliant. I was just pure laughing while I was going at it, and I was just making him even more raging. I'm like, oh, brilliant, mate.
He's not taking this seriously. And was it the same with the Rangers side, or kind of old Rangers legends and stuff, man, like, so that's like, amazing.
Marvin Andrews was there.
No
Malcolm
way.
Charlie Miller and that. It's just amazing.
Wow.
I'm just getting a bit of banter with Bob Malcolm. Like, I was talking to him on Twitter with James English, and we were taking the piss saying we were going to Hoff Bob Malcolm, and then like before the game you're like shaking everybody's hands, and Bob Malcolm's like, I just grab a horn when I let me go, he's like, make sure you've got your shin guards on, pal. Like, oh yes.
That's good stuff.
That's amazing.
So good, mate.
So what was the cause for
it was for like food banks and homeless charities and stuff in the east and the northeast of Glasgow. So great cause. I think we raised all sorts of money. Like,
that's amazing. And
then there was like a food bank drive as well, all sorts of food. Just brilliant, man. So good cause, and it was great fun. So
brilliant,
everyone's
man.
A winner, man. It's amazing.
Definitely.
So it was amazing.
That's honestly so good to hear.
Amazing, mate.
See, the so how did that come about? It was just now with what you're doing, basically the profile's getting bigger and they're like,
so,
you want to come and play,
man.
And
they
knew you were a Celtic fan as well.
Except, mate, I think it's just basically, man, I am basically like a kind of Z-list celebrity now, so that's the kind of minimum requirement to get in there, so
that's really cool.
I'll take that.
Now, another thing I really was impressed with, I thought was hilarious, great concept, was the whole tenants thing.
That was brilliant, man.
So how did that come about, and if you want to tell people I haven't seen it, that was all about?
Tenants were launching this new beer. Well, every bottle of beer had like a different letter alphabet on it, and you would get like a 12 pack or whatever, and you could spell it like Scottish words and that, whatever. And so to launch it, because it was like kind of like word based and that, and a Scottish brand, like get a Scottish writer, so they got me involved. Now I love tenants, know what I mean? So we went through to Edinburgh during the Fringe, and we filmed this wee video where it was like a spelling bee. So like I would go up to people on the street, ask them if they could spell, like go up to tourists, mm-hmm. ask them if they could spell like Scottish words, mm-hmm. and then if they go to write, they would get a bottle of beer. And then package it up, put it in this wee video and put it online, man. It's brilliant. That was another cracking day. That was good, man.
What were some of your favourite words that tourists were spelling?
It's good, man. I was getting them to spell hoaching and glaikit and all that, like proper like Scottish kind of slang words, man. Yeah. Just the confusion on their faces.
I'd love to hear Eugene spelling some of that.
we need to do that with him. We should. There was a couple of words I didn't even know.
No?
I don't know. I mean, well, mind, I'm from Italy, you know what I mean? With his accent and all that. Like, there was a couple of words that were like proper Scots. I'm like, well, nobody really uses them, I don't think. They were old school.
Aye, man.
And also, there was a wee cameo from a friend, Alan Bissett.
Aye, legend.
Alan was in the video, and he's one of the Scottish people you speak to.
That's right.
Do you know Alan now just through what you're doing, or did you know him before?
Done a couple of, like, me and him have been on the same kind of bill for doing readings and stuff. So I met him one night, it was a thing in Clydebank.
Great guy,
and,
man.
I just had to ask him, he's a cracking guy.
Cracking guy.
Yeah, he's nice. Like,
obviously, amazingly talented writer, but just a great guy as well. Just a great human being. Just lovely, lovely guy.
Good
funny
laugh.
Guy, don't tell us. He was kind of like the same as me. I think he said, like, with his writing, he was like, if I'm not doing this full time by the time I'm 30, then I'm kind of chucking it. So I'm just going to, before I'm 30, I'm just going to give everything up and try and make a living off my writing. And that's what he did. He just threw himself into it. He was doing events, writing all sorts, writing plays, doing his own kind of, like kind of stand-up thing he does, like the Moira monologues where he plays this character Moira, like kind of cleaner, and it's just non-stop, mate. And like that was one of my kind of inspirations. I was like, aye, man, like I was like talking to him and hearing how he'd done it, I was like, aye, man, like
I can do this,
man. Like, that's what it's all about. And just like his attitude and his energy when he was telling me about it, I was like, oh, just pure infectious. I was like, aye, I can do this.
That's what it's all about though, really, isn't it?
That's it, mate. Aye.
It's like he's vibing off other people in a similar scene, or
that's it, man.
Learning for peers.
That's it, big time, man.
He's been doing it a long time, and
aye.
He's a legend, man. He's a legend. We've done some stuff with Alan over the years.
Aye.
Yeah. 2014 was it?
Aye, man. Wow, man. A while ago now.
September.
So we're obviously live today. Now you'd put a wee tweet out asking some people to ask some questions. So I'm hoping we can maybe get some questions from the crowd and the Twitter sphere.
I go for it.
And then after we do that, we can maybe get a wee chat about what stuff you've got coming up and that what's next. You know,
that's good money.
We got him there, Kirkie.
Yeah, I'll pass him over to you.
Right, so let me have a look.
Go for it.
So this is on the Twitter, right?
Right.
So first one, so many of them are Celtic related, right? Aye. How many bees does it take to please Lee Griffiths? So what's this about you're saying it's a video? I've not seen this.
Just I'm mad. It's like a viral video's gone about on, I think it's on YouTube.
And he's a beekeeper.
Somebody's made this wee cartoon where Lee Griffiths is like really into bees.
Right.
It's just surreal, man. Like, I can't be justice, man.
No, you can't explain that.
I write some weird shit, and this is one of the weirdest things I've ever seen in my life. It's class.
Right, well, I've got a serious question here, is good. So, we have Sophie McNaughton, mm-hmm. and she's asking, do you have a regular writing routine schedule that you stick to? Mm-hmm. Do you have any writing habits or tips for motivating yourself to get a story finished? That's a great question.
That's a good gene. Aye. For writing routine, it's just the hardest thing is just sitting down and doing it. That is the hardest
starting.
Thing. That's it, getting started. That is the hardest thing. For me, like I've got like a wee notebook full of just ideas, like wee half ideas, like maybe just a character or like just a weird premise and stuff. And I just, just any mad thought I have, I just try and draw that down because you don't know, it might come back to you in the future.
Then you can use something, on it or something.
You can build it into something else, expand on it, like you're saying. So I do that. So like that way, you're never really stuck for ideas. If you feel as if things are kind of drying up, you can flick through that and you'll find something. You know what I mean? You can just put two mad ideas together and make something for that. For me, it's like setting aside time each day. Like I say, it's like 3 hours a day is probably my kind of like sweet spot. You know what I mean? If you can find that 3 hours, whether it's at night time or broken up through the day, do you know what I mean? When I was working, I was doing it like on my break at work and stuff like that. Just try and get that 3 hours or whatever works for you, mm-hmm. and try and force yourself to do it every day. That makes a big difference.
What about actually finishing?
Finishing, man, aye.
Because that's the hardest. It's exactly the same with music production. It's the hardest one, aye. Everyone it comes to us, it's actually, how do I get it over the line to get it done?
I know, that's the thing.
And when it's done?
That's it.
When it's done.
Oh, man, because there's a lot of times I get kind of halfway through a story and I'm thinking, I don't really feel as if this is going anywhere. I feel like it's kind of falling a wee bit flat. It's not up too much. Is it worth finishing or no? But most of the time it is. Most of the time it is just worth powering through it and trying to see where else you can take it. But sometimes you do need to know when to kind of let go, when you know, this isn't up too much. But don't scrap it. Like, I've got a wee folder on my computer. It's called Shite Stories. And it's fans I've no finished.
That needs to be a book title, man. Shite Stories. That's one of them.
And it's like half finished stories. And if I just think, this can't go any further, I'll just drag it in there. Maybe in the future, I'll be able to go back to it.
These things sit in your mind, don't they? And they sit and kind of boil over, aye, over time. There's ideas I've been back to a year and a half later.
Aye.
And then the magic's popped in.
That's it, man.
So it's good to ask.
Aye,
good way to do it. Good advice.
Aye, cheers, man. Aye.
So I've got Shaun of the Dead, who's asking, if you could leather any fictional character, who would it be? I love that. Oh, I'm going to have a think as well. We all need to answer this. Who would we leather?
That's a good gene. I don't know, man.
Oh, man, that's such a hard one. Oh, God.
I'll try to think.
Leather,
who do I not like? Who's a bit of an arse?
I'm sure there's definitely a few out there. few arses out there. Hey. No idea, man.
That's a question.
Fictional characters. I'm trying, like, right now, so if we see when somebody like tell a joke or do something, it's like, you can't think
it. Panic.
What's your favourite tune of that?
I don't listen to music.
I don't know any tunes. I mean, fictional character.
I'd like to get in a ring with Begbie for Trainspotting just to see how good he is. Really, at fighting.
Oh, that's cool.
And to take a doing, off Begbie, I'd kill him. To take a doing off Begbie would be quite cool. No? I should tell people that.
So it's not you leathering.
That's a good answer.
That is a good answer. It's very diplomatic.
Who do I? I don't know. Who could I leather? No many people, to be honest.
I'm trying to think of wee annoying fictional characters. I just don't know. I kind of think.
I think there is definitely one. I'm trying to like think of the Avengers or Entler, you know, I'm trying to get it in. But okay, well, we'll maybe come back, but that's cool. Right, so you intend to do what if it begs me from
love to get in a ring with Begbie, eh? Right.
I just don't know who's doing the leather in there, that's the thing.
It will not be me.
Right, so we have the weasel. Do you miss Chad Uri?
every day.
And Daniel's asking, will you be my dad?
I need to get a miss.
No wonder.
But if you're really struggling for that, give me a shout. We'll see what I can do, mate.
This one I spoke to you about earlier, and it's maybe even divided us three here.
Right, aye.
Beans on a fry up, aye or not, that's for Barca Jim. It's an off of me, man. Not on it. You'd have it.
What do you mean on a side plate? You'd have it.
He just says beans on a fryer.
I definitely have it on the same plate.
Of course.
Aye.
And
but would I you mean, spread it over?
If it goes over things, aye.
Well, I mean, I mean, thing is, you have it mixed. I mean, you have it with a bit of black pudding, a bit of egg and all that.
Aye.
But pure mixing it all together.
I mean, not like spread over 100% of the plate. That'd be odd. But if it covers a bit of the potato scone or the egg, covers a wee bit of the bacon or that. Totally into that.
How can you not be into that? I like it separate. I don't like the sauce touching it.
So you have it like in a wee ramekin or something?
I'll have it on the plate, but I'll kind of make a wee dam. Like,
so nothing can get
like,
to it.
Aye, man. Maybe like the sausage and then the tortoise going kind of square half corner, box right. half, so it's no touching box the egg in that.
Aye, but then you just eat them on their own. And
I'll mix it. I just don't like it touching on the plate. It's weird, man.
It's a runny hook in the bean sauce.
Aye,
does that freak you out a bit? It makes that kind of mad colour.
Aye,
that's pretty weird.
I like it
as well, right? So I'm trying to see if there's any. I mean, it's actually made me hungry now. That's kind of the way. So there's Daniel Stevenson on the page saying, I hope that's my copy of HWFG on the table you're dropping off after this podcast. Is that a mate of yours?
That is my name, somebody.
Brilliant. Well, nah, hopefully it's no mate. Hopefully it's ours, right? No, but that's pretty cool, man. There's mental questions out there, man.
Like, man.
There's, the thing is as well, because I announced it quite late, I'd imagine, and plus you're trying to stay under the radar now, man. So how is that working though? Because obviously you're still just punting what you're doing and pushing the book and all that.
I think it's because like the email address I signed up with this new Twitter, isn't it? Like Chris McQueer at Gmail, I thought it's like
a new thing.
The unknown man
just at aye, man, aye. So like I don't know, because Twitter, like the official Twitter account was tweeting. Like, it was hard to say, man. They were tweeting a couple of weeks ago saying like they were looking for people who had set up new accounts who had previously been banned.
Right.
I was like, oof, man. Hiding up the loft. So I was man, like,
I'm sure if it went to an appeal stage, it would be fine, though, because it's not like it was a once, one-off kind of thing. Do you know what I mean? Like,
unless Remy shows up dead soon.
Know.
You might be buggered.
Now that's a problem.
Losing my Twitter account would be the least of all. Yeah.
No.
That's mental. So, right, well, we've got to some of the questions. Some of them are a bit too mental. What's coming up next then? Where can people see you? When is the book due out? And what shows or gigs or anything like that's happening? This is time for you to plug what you want, my man.
Hey, I've got quite a lot coming up. So this is my new book. This is the main man. This is HWFG. Here we fucking go. So on the 8th of November. You can pre-order it now for 404inc.com. And you'll get like a wee handwritten thank you message from me.
So, nice.
A wee nice wee touch, man.
I like it.
So you get that and you get a free bookmark as well. Okay. Can't say fair on that.
So you need to do that.
You can't.
It's a must.
You can't.
Aye, man. And you'll be able to get it for Waterstones and Amazon and all that as well. I'll be launching it on the 8th of November in Waterstones on Argyle Street with Big Stuart Cosgrove. He's going to be interviewing me, the big man for Off the Ball. He's going to be interviewing me.
Amazing.
And then we're going to have a launch party in Stereo in Glasgow on the 10th of November. That's going to be great. I've asked loads of other kind of performers that I've met on the kind of spoken word circuit to come and perform and just help me launch. It's just going to be like a party. It's just going to be a cracking night.
We'll definitely try and make it along as well, mate.
The good boys, aye.
Yes, are tickets to that?
Tickets to that. I don't know where you can get them.
I'm sure we'll people can
aye, well, we
tickets,
can stay in contact.
That's fine.
Aye, put a link in the description.
That's what we'll do. In the description, of course. yeah.
What else? The morrow night, Thursday night, I'm going to be doing in Ayrshire. I'm going to be, don't laugh now, I'm performing in the Dick Institute down in Ayrshire. Exactly.
Sorry, I laughed.
That's going to be, I'm going to be in conversation with another track writer. His name's David Ross. So he's going to be kind of interviewing me, and I'm going to be reading a couple of stories, and that's going to be a good night.
Excellent. And,
aye, that's kind of everything. So,
nice one, man. Nice one.
Sounds good.
Brilliant, man.
Good to catch up again.
Yes.
Yeah, it's good to see
episode
you.
Episode two.
I've enjoyed hearing the latest over a year. You know, as you say, so much changes.
So much has. And odd to see you doing it full time and that, and just fantastic. Constantly getting busier and busier. It's great.
It's terrifying, mate. I've got the fear, but that's what motivates me, you know what I mean? Like, just the thought of, like, because there's not a lot of money in writing books, so, like, the more you work, yeah, the money you make, that's what you need today. You just need to keep at it. So,
in fact, you're doing something you enjoy, though. That's the fire, isn't it?
I mean, that's exactly that, man.
Like, totally.
I'd be doing it for the money. Not
exactly. And if you had millions, you'd be doing the same
thing. Still be doing it. Still doing the exact same thing, man.
That's what I've always said. Like, see, when at the point when I made that call, I was like, if I had millions in the bank, I'd still be making music. I'd still be wanting to be in about a studio.
That's it,
all day.
Exactly.
So it's a good anchor point, you know what I mean? Definitely. I like that word, anchor point.
I also just think that the fact that you, when you first done the book, it was just a hobby, you were doing it for fun.
Aye.
It definitely changes the dynamic now that it's a career, but you take it more seriously, and if anything, mate, I just think it will get better.
Cheers,
of course
man.
It will.
Fingers crossed, right, mate.
You know.
Brilliant, man. So, yeah, we've just had Chris McQueer once again.
The very talented Chris McQueer. Thank you very much for coming in again.
Oh, cheers,
man. Yes, until next time, my man.
All the best.
Yes.
Brilliant.
Okay, see you all soon.
Yes. Everywhere. Loads of cameras today.